All right, in previous discussions, we've talked about the immovable joints of the skull, or the sutures, and that is quite a few joints, but we're going to talk about the only movable joint of the skull, which is your temporomandibular joint. And colloquially, we often refer to this as TMJ. Now, typically when people talk about TMJ, they're talking about TMJ syndrome, which we'll talk about towards the end of this lecture. But it's actually an abbreviation for the bones that are that compose this joint, the temporo and the mandibular. So let's talk about what bones those are. So the two bones that are going to make up your TMJ joint are your temporal bone and your mandible. Now, specifically, when we're talking about the temporal bone, we're looking at an inferior view here. You can see this shallow area right past the zygomatic arch. And this shallow area is referred to as the mandibular fossa. It's basically a divot that's going to allow for the mandibular condyle of the mandible to fit or articulate with the skull. So the skull is what's not moving. The mandible is the movable part of your TMJ joint. So if you think about opening and closing your mouth, it's your mandible that's moving, not your skull. So there's no movable joints truly associated with the skull. Now, this is one of your first visits in terms of a dissection-based atlas, and that's what you're going to be seeing in when we're talking about muscles and ligaments in great detail as we go further. So right here, we're looking at an actual component of the TMJ, and you can see right here is your articular disc. So the temporal bone is going to be right here. Your mandibles right here, your mandibular condyle, and in between, you're going to have a disc which is made up of fibrocartilage. Now, the articular disc in your TMJ is of particular importance because it divides the joint into a superior compartment and an inferior compartment. And there's going to be two completely different types of movements that can occur here. So let's talk about those movements in just a moment. So first we're going to talk about the clinical considerations that can occur here. Now you can have a dislocated mandible. Now what that means is that your mandibular condyle pops out of place, and when you have this occur, this actually will occur with the mandibular condyle, which typically sits right here, will pop out and move anterior to your articular eminence. So we talked about the articular eminence when we were talking about bones. It's basically that inferior projection of the zygomatic arch. So you'll have the mandibular condyle move inferiorly and then anteriorly. So that can happen with a blow to the side of the face. Sometimes if you have a weakening of the ligaments in this region, it can happen when you yawn very wide, or if you're eating something that's rather large, it can happen just as easily in that particular situation as well. Now, TMJ syndrome, which is what we typically think of when we think of TMJ, is really an amalgamation of all kinds of different things. It could just be a slight weakening of the ligaments in this region. It can have something to do with the articular disc of your TMJ joint. It can have something to do with a dislocation in addition to that as well. So any type of damage or injury in this area can be considered part of TMJ syndrome. Now, typically, what can help with TMJ syndrome is actually just not using your temporomandibular joint. So that's the more common clinical prescription for this is to just stop using your TMJ joint and allow for the structures of the joint to kind of relax and become less inflamed. So let's talk about the movements that can occur here. Now remember how we talked about how that articular disc is actually going to divide the joint into two different compartments. So you're going to have the inferior compartment playing a bigger role in terms of the more dominant movement at the TMJ, which is elevation and depression. So if you think about that, if you elevate, that's closing your mouth. Depression is opening your mouth. So opening and closing. So this is an example of a hinge joint. Now the superior compartment is doing more of a sliding back and forth, and that's what's referred to as protraction and retraction. So let's actually see what these movements are. So we're going to start, I believe, with protraction and retraction. So really pay attention. Protraction, think of jutting out your chin, and retraction, going back to anatomical position. So protraction, jutting out, retraction, going back into anatomical position. Now, in terms of the larger movement, you have depression and elevation. So depression, opening the mouth. You can have various range of motion there. Elevation, going back to anatomical position. So you can see the two main types of movements that can occur depending on which compartment is actually moving based on that articular disc. Now, we'll talk later about the four muscles of mastication that will actually allow for these movements to occur.